This is Neil Jones joining me on the show. It's been a while since we've had them on the show. They are back with a brand new album. It is Seven Dust, and we are speaking to Legion. How are you, sir? Good to see you.
I'm fantastic. It's a pleasure to talk to you and feel your energy from over there, man. I love it.
Hey, listen, I can see you now. I can see you on camera. You are surrounded by gold discs from Seven Dust. I mean, I was just thinking, actually, what a lengthy and successful career it's been for the band. And I just thought, when did the band start? So I jumped onto that fountain of knowledge that all journalists use, which we never should, which is Wikipedia.
Yeah, yes.
It told me that it was 1994, which means that you're approaching 30 years as the band. Which is staggering. I know you were you there. What year did you join the band? Were you there in 94? Were you a couple of years beyond?
Yeah, I was there at the very beginning. I was very young. I wasn't able to drink, and I was so young that they kind of pulled me and plucked me from another band and said, "We think you're cool." And I remember the first time that I hung out with the guys and I did a shot of what is it called? Goldschlager. Mm. And I ran to the bathroom and threw up, and I was like, "Okay, I guess this is what's getting ready to start happening." And I was 21 years old. We signed a record deal and we've not turned back since, man. I was 21 years old. Yeah, when we signed the record deal with TBT Records.
Do you know what? I've only had Goldschlager once too, and I also ran to the bathroom and threw up. So it's like a rite of passage, isn't it?
Yeah, never had it since. Never had it since. I'm 50 years old. Never had Goldschlager since.
we were just talking off camera there that, you know, this is your man cave that you're in. When you sit there and occasionally just glance at those gold records, you know, you've had Grammy nominations, loads of gold albums. Do you allow yourself a moment to think, damn, we have had a successful career?
Wow. I don't know until you said it like that, bro. You know, I come in here and I look at things and I'm like, oh, wow, this is so cool. It's like a museum. And I pick up things and you just said the Grammy. Share this with you. All the way to the Grammys, took the whole family. It was incredible. The whole experience. Ghost won the Grammy. This is what they send you with. You get a certificate.
Oh, look at that.
And this.
Look at that. That is amazing.
That's what you get. I would have thought it would have been bigger, but that's cool. And, you know, it's something I'm gonna end up, you know, presenting it on the wall and everything. But that was, you know, that to me was an experience too. I would never take that back, because growing up as a kid, watching the Grammys was like, oh, my God.
Yeah.
People that you would never think that you ever get close to. Damn sure knowing you're not going to ever go to a concert because you can't afford it. And for me, as that young man, to be behind one row with my wife sitting here holding my hand and Stevie Wonder sitting in front of me.
Wow.
What are you talking about? I'm like, I could throw something at him. He wouldn't know it was me, but I could say I did that. You know what I'm saying?
I've heard the Grammys is also the longest award ceremony, that it just goes on for hours. Is that right?
Let me tell you what happens. What you see on TV has nothing to do with what they put you through as the smaller artist. We went to something, an award show where we got presented and then Ghost won it. I've never seen so many. There was like a Jamaican tap dancing gospel act. Grammy. It was like, what?
They have a category for everything, basically.
It was like, it's like, this guy is the number one spittoon. You know what I mean? It was like, I've never seen so many awards. But it was a beautiful experience to be a part of it, even up to the point to where we didn't win the Grammy. I remember my wife sitting there and we saw Dave Grohl walk in with the band Ghost. And I was like, man, something's weird. And all of a sudden they were like the nominees. And they said the band Ghost. And I was like, oh, and my wife said, no. I remember grabbing her hand. I was like, oh, my God, everyone heard you say no.
Gracious in defeat.
Yeah, but you know what, man? What an experience. I wouldn't change that for anything. And we have that under our belt. And it was very cool to be there, to be a part, to see the people. It was cool.
My just before we talk about your new album, my two favorite memories of the Grammys for the wrong reasons both involve Metallica. One is when, of course, Jethro Tull beat Metallica in the category of best metal performance, which the entire metal world is still scratching its head over. And the other one was when Megadeth won their album for Dystopia, and he walked down the carpet to go on stage, and they played Metallica's music instead of Megadeth's by mistake.
It's so crazy. Yes, that's still to this day is brutal to me to understand. I'll tell you a story before we go on. So the Grammys, I was able to bring out my best friend, which was Jamie Shields, the pitcher, famous pitcher. He's retired now. Big Game James, his family. And we were standing right across the street from the Staples Center where they have it at. After the Grammys, we're all like hanging out. We're going to go back over to our spot and maybe have like a little party in the bar area. And Tech N9ne, which was my neighbor, still here in town, a rapper, came over and all hanging out. And I remember James Shields looking at me. He was like, "Hey, man, why don't we go to the after party?" And I was like, "Yeah, no, I don't want to. Let's just hang out here." And he looked at me. He's like, "Man, you know what, man? If I would have had that same attitude, you know, with the World Series and stuff and missing things," he's like, "you never know if you have this opportunity again. Let's go." Yeah. Let me tell you what. We went to the after party at the Grammys. It was like walking into, you think about being in Hollywood, not thinking about being in Hollywood, but we walked in these double doors in this arena. And it was themed after what's the Johnny Depp movie where he's underground, Alice in Wonderland or whatever.
Yeah.
So when you walked in, there were people not like on regular stilts, but 100 feet in the air.
Wow.
Like everything was themed. It was over the top. The table of food, free gifts, everything. And as I was in there, I'm like, "Oh my God, this is kind of overwhelming. They're giving us stuff." And James Shields, we're eating stuff. We're like, "This is amazing. Drinks are free." We're laughing. And I'm dancing. And I'm looking way down here. And I'm like, "Who's that?" And I'm like, "I hear this song." It's like, "I will testify. I'm in another man of love. And I'm in no real life. I love my love to live." It was that lady from the 1970s on the freaking stage. Singing "I Will Survive," and it was like, "Are we in like what is happening right now?" You could film commercials before you walked out for McDonald's. And you know what, me and him laughed at each other and hugged each other and said, "Man, this is probably one of the best times." Just something that you would have never experienced. So the Grammys for me was really cool.
Gloria Gaynor, was that who it was?
Yeah, oh my God, yes. Listen, let me tell you, when I saw her, I'm like running around and people are like, not a lot of people, but it was the industry. So, you know, there are people dancing. I'm like, it's her. I'm like, you know what I mean? It was like, for me, it was like, "Oh my God, what is happening?"
Oh, I love it. I love it. Well, listen, let's hope you get loads more Grammy nominations. And actually, The new album, let's talk about the new album, Truth. Yes. I want to talk about that title, first of all, because we live in the age when no one really knows what the truth is anymore. We've got a president who talks about, you know, what does he call it? False news. You go on social media. What is the truth anymore?
Fake news.
Is that what it's alluding to?
Oh, yes. So listen, I feel like not only that guy, but there's so many truth killers. The mailman, the Uber driver, the taxi driver. Everyone has an opinion. Who's telling the truth? That's their own truth. And that's what I feel like truth killer is to me. You know what I mean? It's just like, wow, like you just said, that guy that just spits out the social media, they feed you what they want. And I just feel like that's the truth killer. Like, you have to believe in something, but at the end of the day, know the honest truth. It's like, let's not follow these crazy people. That's what I, you know, not to be...
Absolutely. 14th studio album as well. The last one, 2021, Blood and Stone, was so well received. So well received. There it is. Look, Billboard.
We didn't get to tour it.
And you didn't get to tour it, no doubt, because of COVID. So have those songs ever been played live yet then on the previous album?
Yeah, we play some of the songs live, and I feel like that'll be something that we'll be able to bring back into the set now that the world is opening up again. Because if you think about it, we did the Animosity run, and it was the Animosity. We did it for Three Legs. And now we went out with Alter Bridge in lieu of the release of the new album. Put a new song in, Fence, which has gone over well. So when we go back in August with Mammoth and Alter Bridge, we'll be able to put in some more songs and some songs from Blood and Stone. We only have a 45-minute set, so it's kind of hard to pick, but it's going to be fun to do it.
I mean, it's impossible not to still talk about COVID, but because, you know, the world was just unbelievable for a couple of years.
Yes.
A lot of artists just basically couldn't tour. So they wrote music. Were you as a band, or were you as an individual legend? Were you sitting on a stockpile of songs because you just, you know, got to work and kept busy creating? Or did you just, you know, when it came to approaching this album, did you just start from scratch post COVID?
Yeah, that's a really cool question. So for whatever reason, during COVID, we were able to do we had the means to be able to go into a disclosed location and record Seven Dust Live stream. So I think we did that maybe three times over the pandemic. So it kept people, if you like Seven Dust, you were able to buy it and watch it in your living room. And it was us in a doing a show, which was weird. Ask the question again, because I kind of went away from it.
Just about when the songs were written. Were they written in a period of time?
No. So this is a good guy. That's why I was wanting to make sure I answered it right. This album was really cool. I was able to bring Clint down to the farmhouse that my wife's grandparents left us. Grandpa died at 96 years old. We remodeled everything, put everything new, kept a lot of the character in it. It was a musical house anyway. And when I was there, the 300 acres, we maintained about 15 with some cattle. And I said, this is the perfect place to write music. Why would we not do this or something here? Mm-hmm. Clint came down. We wrote a couple of songs, brought the band Seven Dust down. And imagine this. It reminded me of being that band when we were young and having to find a place to jam. Mm-hmm. Even though the house is set up, but think about this. We're in grandma's room. Grandpa slept in the living room in a recliner. So it's everything's different, but there's not the same grandma's bed. Anyways, Morgan's drum set in front of this bed, Vinny sitting on the end of the bed, and John on the other end of the bed, Clint behind a computer and a mic stand, and us writing Seven Dust songs, wow, looking at the cows and seeing the sunset. And man, it was so real and it was so fun. I feel like it really put the energy on this album, because it was just us being, it felt like us being those young men, you know, just trying to find a place to jam. And then the next night, I remember the sunset was going down, this beautiful view, and we had to move to do guitars and bass in another room. And I just kind of walked out in the front and the flag is flying, and it's nothing but acres. And Vinny and John are in the front window like, and I'm like, if anyone knew on this dirt gravel road what was happening in this house right now, it would just be, you know what I mean? It was just such an amazing feeling. And then to take that to Elvis's spot, where you're in this big old mansion and it's still the magic energy. But for us to do it that way, together, tight, waking up in the morning, right on, you know, that's us. That's the real deal.
And no neighbors to disturb, of course. It sounds like you're in the middle of nowhere.
No neighbors at all. The one morning that John Conley woke up, because he runs every morning, I remember him looking out the window and drinking coffee and looking to the left. He's like, hey, LJ. I was like, what? He's like, man, I think one of your baby cows are out of the gate. And I was like, no, that's a new gate. It's no way. I said, it looks like it. He's like, okay. He's like, no, he looks like he's coming up here towards me. Sure enough, me and John Conley are outside. There's a calf outside the gate. John's got on some biker running shorts and some weird tank top, doing like this right here. I'm like, stop doing that. You're freaking him out. Stop doing that in that outfit. And we cattled it back up. And you know, it was so funny, because right after that, we went inside and wrote a Seven Dust song. So it was the most.
I love the vibe of being in that house. That's amazing. So different. When you got there, did you have any rough demos or anything? Or did you literally?
Yeah, we had. So we had a couple of ideas, you know, like everyone has ideas, like John will write something at his house, Clint will write something, I could write something here at the house, and we'll have some rough ideas. But let me tell you, the best time for us is when we get together as a band and we're looking at each other and everybody. It's still the same thing. It's like those young kids in a jam room. Once we get together and everyone's feeding off each other, to this day, it's still, that's the best time. That's the best writing for me.
Which, of course, during COVID, you know, I spoke to some bands who weren't even in the same country when they put their albums together, because the technology allows it, doesn't it? But it isn't the same for you guys, is it?
It's not the same. And, you know, we've done things like that. You know, the songs turn out good and stuff, but until you're in that room looking at each other, looking like, you don't think that's cool. You know what I mean?
Eyeball to eyeball.
There you go. That's when you know it's like, oh, maybe I need to is it cool now? Yeah, I get it. The thing about our band, it's always been something funny. If we do something and someone brings something, and if you think it's cool, then you know it's not cool. If you have to say that.
And body language says more than words, doesn't it?
There you go. Like, if you're like, hey man, you like this? I'm like, yeah, you think it's cool? Then you already know. No. Did you just ask me if I think it's cool? Yeah, obviously I think.
B- Big clue. Going back to the streams, I was talking to one band and it really made me laugh. They said that the weirdest thing about doing those live streams was when you finished a song, obviously there's, you can hear a pin drop. And he said, it was like the early gigs that we used to play when there was no one there. Was it the same for you guys?
I'll tell you what. So at the beginning of our streams, I had to stop. So we would finish a song and you would hear like the drum tech and the guitar tech be like, yeah. I said, stop. I was like, all right, listen, if it's only going to be two of you guys, because there's only four of you guys in here, stop. Don't clap. Do not clap.
I'd rather have nothing.
And then it gets really bad, because the first time we did it, I remember coming back home and then the wife looking at me and be like, hey, you know, next time you do it, maybe wave over here. And I'm like, what? She's like, you weren't looking enough into the left side of the living room. I'm like, are you kidding me?
And these are things you've never had to worry about before, of course.
Yeah, but it made sense. I'm like, oh my God, you're right. She's like, yeah. I'm like, yeah, I thought I was talking to them. She's like, but you weren't talking to grandma in the recliner that was sitting way over there. She felt left out of the concert.
Oh, I love
it. I get it.
I love it. You've obviously got your solo career as well. Are you still, how are you mixing the kind of Seven Dust versus the solo stuff these days?
Oh, thank you for asking. Actually, I fly out of here Sunday in a couple of days to go finish writing. I've been writing with a beautiful team, Andrew Ballas, Michael Whitworth, and Dan, and these guys are the prominent writers for the Man Jelly Roll and several other big artists. And we've written several songs and it's been incredible. I'm taking my time. Seven Dust is the most important thing, but I cannot wait to allow people to hear my other side. I mean, it's not too crazy, but it's a lot more soulful. Maybe even some country stuff in there too, but it's been fun to work and to be able to work with these other artists and bring back what I learned to the Seven Dust camp.
Yeah.
It's like when we all, you know what I mean? Like when we all go out and work together and do different things, everyone has their projects, but I'm really excited about my solo thing. And there's some label interest and we'll see what happens after the Seven Dust thing slows down.
And if you're, let's say you're driving the car or perhaps you're in the shower where ideas come to you and maybe a melody sticks in your head, how do you know if you think, you know what, that one's going to go in the back pocket, that's going to be for the solo album rather than Seven Dust? How do you know where to use it?
I don't do that. The song comes to me at the moment.
Okay.
You know, I still listen to it, but I would never think about like, oh, that's a Seven Dust song or that's me. You know, I would never think of a melody that way. It's only fitting at the time, if that makes sense.
Yeah.
With me, I'm in the moment type of person. I don't like to always sit down and do this forcefully.
Sure.
Because to me, in the moment when I hear the song, that's when I'm captured. And whatever moves me is when I'm right. And a lot of times, a song to me might not come from here. It just comes from here.
Yep.
Record it. Take it. Get that tech. You got that? All right. That's where I'm feeling. You know what I mean? And some songs come from that way. And I still like to write with, I don't write with regular pen. I write with old felt. You know, I'm still old school.
Look at that. That's old school. For those of our people listening on the radio, they can't actually see it. That is an old school nib of a pen there, isn't it? Look at that thing.
Yeah. Yeah, so for me, it's the nostalgia of that. And sometimes I might write a verse down in the calligraphy, you know, and just for me, that's like, oh, wow, it's cool. But it's so much modern technology from recording from here to that. But sometimes I think some songs need that certain.
Yeah.
Just like when a writer would not write with his hand, but then he would go to a typewriter. You know what I mean? It's still sometimes you need that in your craft. And I like to do that every once in a while.
I think you should take it back even further, Legend, and have a quill and a parchment, I think.
Oh my God, like, yes. Man, I wish you were here right now in my bar. I have so many old school things from spectacles to we can make that happen. From even this globe. So this globe right here that I collected is actually not the way the world looks now, but the only reason I have this is because this is the first one that has an actual light bulb in it.
Oh, wow.
So, amazing. So I don't know. I have to look back and I have a tag on it, but I think it was from like whenever the first light bulb came, but it's in that bulb. It's in that globe.
Amazing. Yeah. Hey, listen, just before we wrap up, just before we started the interview, you and I drifted conveniently onto the topic of Lemmy. We're all big
Oh my God. Fans,
but I know that you were friends with Lemmy. You were talking about going to the Astoria, which is my favorite venue in London, and you went there with Lemmy. Just tell us that Lemmy story again.
Well, I could tell you the first time that I met Lemmy when we played the Barfly. Is that still a place in London?
The venue is there. It's not called the Barfly, but the place is still there, yeah.
Oh, my God. I remember sitting in this little bitty backstage area that was like this big, and the actual couch that we sat on was, I believe, a seat from a truck, like a truck.
Yeah.
A bench. So anyway, knock on the door. Lemmy's in town from Motorhead. He lives here or whatever. He's in town. He wants to see you. I'm like, what? Okay, whatever. That was my first introduction to Lemmy. He came in and sat down with me, told me the story about how he thought that we were incredible and what we were doing and how he worked for Jimi Hendrix.
Yeah.
Was his guitar tech. And that was important to him because he wanted me to understand that back then it was weird. It was like he was letting me know that it was cool that I was doing what I was doing as a black man.
Yeah.
And does he understand what I'm saying? He was like,
yeah.
He said, don't mess this up. I was like, yes, sir. After that, we ended up doing the Ozfest, and me and Lemmy hung out. I don't know. It was just weird for me. But anyway, the Astoria, overseas, we were doing, I think maybe it was the Ozfest, some tour we were over there, and Lemmy invited me to go meet one of his good friends. And it was me, and I showed up at the Astoria in London, this young man hanging out with Lemmy, and I'm all of a sudden, he introduced me to Alice Cooper. And I'm like, what? And we're hanging out. We're buddies at this time, man. I mean, we hung out. So listen, so fast forwarded years and years later, I was able to introduce him to my whole family because we would go to Rancho Cucamonga where my wife's mother has a spot. And we would always make sure that we would go down to the Rainbow. Lemmy always hangs at the Rainbow Room.
Cool.
This one day he happened to be at the bar and I have pictures with him and my kids. And he was, you know, older and he was more frail. But he still remembered our connection that we had. Exactly. And it was very special, man, because he was so cool. I mean, even the story about, he said, hey, LJ, on the Ozfest tour, we stayed this old beat down Holiday Inn. And I remember our tour bus pulling out in the back and it was this hill and freaking Lemmy had a Speedo on suntan. I was like, oh my God, something you can't unsee. I was like, this is weird. And I remember him saying, LJ, and his room happened to be on that first level. He's like, come in here. I got something to show you. And he walked in with his Speedos. I'm like, oh, God, this is awesome.
The legendary Lemmy Speedo.
You cannot make this up. And as I walked in his hotel room, it wasn't nice. It was just a regular Holiday Inn. But this is where we had to stay at on that tour. And as I walked through the front door, right there is the closet. And it was his clothes. And immediately I'm looking at the leather vest and I'm like picking up the boots and I'm like, oh my God, I'm trying stuff on. He's laughing at me. And up on the top is there's memorabilia. And he's, ah, oh, man, that's some of that World War II. He's like, don't even think I'm that guy. But I remember him saying like, don't feel weird about that. I collect that stuff. But he wanted to make sure that I wasn't uncomfortable. But I had on his white boots at that point in time.
Amazing.
and he's showing me that he wrote a Seven Dust song on a napkin. He said, I think you guys, I would have to find it. But Lemmy was always, you would have never thought that he would be that cool to me. You know what I mean? Like me hanging out in his hotel room, laughing at him with his boots on and a vest on and a fucking Hitler hat on or whatever. Him saying, ah, you know, you can't make it up. He was so genuinely cool, man. I love the fact that we're able to talk about that.
It's funny, isn't it? Between seeing Gloria Gaynor in the Grammys party to sitting in Lemmy's hotel room while he's got Speedos on and you're wearing his Nazi hat. It's just, you kind of wonder where do these surreal moments come from in life, right?
You know what, man? And you can't make it up. It was so real back then. And just the camaraderie. And for him to be the star that he was and to take me under his wing to be so nice to me changed my life. You know what I mean? Like, really changed my life as far as understanding being this different color man in the industry, in the metal world, and then this man right here that's at the top of it, being like, hey, guess what? I got you. And you know what I mean?
He was the absolute best. I had the honor of interviewing him a few times. I actually interviewed him 6 weeks before he passed away as well.
Very no quickly. Way.
Yeah, and I remember, it's very sad to remember, because I remember looking into his eyes, and I said to my friend after, this was at the Classic Rock Awards in London, and I remember saying, turning to my friend and said, you know, he'll be lucky to last the end of the year. I mean, he just
looked so gorgeous.
And having met him so many times over the years, it was like the lights had gone out in his eyes. It was very, very sad. Yep. You could tell it was the end, but he was still funny. He was still Lemmy, you know what I mean? That humor was still
but
there.
But you could see the energy was fading, the light was fading.
Exactly.
You know what, man? I feel, wow, the way you said that, it was like his star lit until the end.
Exactly.
You know what I mean?
Yeah.
It was like a star fading, but he was still there. Exactly. To give us as much as he could until it went out, man. Wow, it just made me almost cry. Jeez, very cool the way you put that. You saw it to the end. And that's the same way I saw it when we were there and he was at the end of the bar. And he was himself, but he was just like, just that, it was the end.
Yeah.
But it was still beautiful that he took the time to hang out with us. And also that day I hung out with Priscilla Presley.
Wow.
They were both at the Rainbow Room. It's weird. So it was something in the energy. Yeah, you can't make it up.
Exactly. Well, listen, I think it's about time we played some music then. We've got Truth.
Yes.
Everything. Is that the new single?
Yeah, so Everything, man. So, Met My Brother, I hope that this song is a homage to everyone that's felt down and it's been down over the, not just only the pandemic, but just in life over the past years with all the obstacle courses, obscure things that we've had to get around to make sure that our life gets back to some type of normalcy. I hope this song is a hurrah to that and just helps people get through life, because I feel like music is a healer, and I'm just a doctor trying to give that medicine out.
Amazing. Well, listen, it's nearly 30 years of Seven Dust. Are you going to celebrate the 3-0 next year? Are you going to do anything special?
Yeah, well, I don't know, man. But since I turned 50 last year, I don't know if we need to be celebrating these things and really letting us know how old we are. They're like, damn, these things are freaking dinosaurs. No, we will. You know, that's a good question. I would like to do the anniversary to like all these albums coming up, like Seasons, the 30-year anniversary of Seven Dust. Yeah, I can't believe that we're still, is the word relevant? Thank you for giving us the opportunity to still do music. And I think that's also due to Napalm giving us the chance to sign a record deal, to have the opportunity to talk to brothers like you. I hadn't talked to anyone internationally in fucking 63 years. It's like, who's Seven Dust? You know what I mean? This is a good sign. I can't wait to be over there with you.
Well, listen, we look forward to having you back on these shores. In the meantime, we will play that song, Everything, from the brand new album. 28th of July, it's out. It is called Truth Killer. And we've been speaking to, do I call you LJ or do I call you Lejon? How do people?
You call me LJ or Lejon, whatever you, I'd like LJ. You're my brother.
We'll go for LJ. LJ, it's been a pleasure catching up with you. Thanks for chatting to us.
You guys have a great weekend. I'll talk to you soon, brother.